Last night in the fourth quarter, all me and Bobby could do is go, I get no minutes. It's a DMP.
Welcome back to another session of Sports Sesh. I'm Guy Young, and these guys are just guys. Now, I want to just jump right into hot topics.
Earliest memory of Dirk, it was probably a year he was playing with Steve Nash. I kept hearing somebody named Dirt, like with a T. So I was like, why is there a dude named Dirt in the league? And then I found out he was actually pretty good. So.
You know, the only way that I know that song, because I'm pretty far behind now, although I did see there's a new Dipset album. The Diplomats have a new album, so that's...
Okay.
But the only way that I know that song exists is from videos that people will take at either college tailgates or college parties.
Mm-hmm.
And it's usually from the SEC, and there's like 99% white kids there, and they're just leaning into the N-word.
Yeah.
And...
That's a trash song.
I've seen this at Hangout, as you have as well. Very popular SEC area. And that's a no go for me.
Yeah,
even in the song lyrics.
And I'm gonna opt out on that one.
That's the only way I know that song, is seeing a bunch of like 21-year-old Ole Miss fans going nuts to it. I don't know that I've ever actually heard it.
What does the edited version say?
Not in a Vine. So that makes me think, when I heard it last night, I knew what it was, though, because I'd heard it from the Vine, which I think Poison Ivy must have been doing a little trolling.
She does that.
Of course.
She did Another One Bites the Dust whenever Dennis lost his tooth. Or no, it was We Will Rock You or whatever, another Queen song. The other Queen song that everybody knows.
Yeah, that was perfect.
Yeah.
It was perfect. And they even called that out on the broadcast.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know that was that song. Like, I had heard that song, I think... at my bachelor party or something, Sean Ray rolled that number, and I'm like, oh, this is a interesting cadence that we're using for this song. Is this the whole thing? And then I knew Sheck West was a person.
Yeah.
And then I knew Mo Bamba was a song. I did not realize that all of them were the same thing. And then Lizelle comes into the office singing that song, and I'm like, because she's like the most on top of it. Like, whatever the number one rap song is right now, she'll be singing it in her head like all day. That's just how she acts in the office. And I was like, what is this song? She's like, that's Mo Bamba. And I'm like, what?
Yeah.
About the same. Okay. And then now I just use it to make funny lyrics about the actual basketball player that are real intricate.
Well, listen, it's a great name.
Bad
no one was
PR.
Ever. No one was ever arguing with the name.
The name is Fuego.
Yeah.
Okay. It is fire, but
he's just got a lot to live up to.
Yeah.
With that name. And it starts probably with not being late.
Is that why he got benched?
I think that's what.
Oh man, I thought he was a smart kid.
Clifford said afterward. Oh. Yeah, that was a weird thing too. Is he said a lot of really weird stuff leading up to the draft, and everyone was telling me like, man, this guy's super smart.
He's too smart.
And a lot of the stuff he was saying seemed to be just kind of what you would say when you think that's what someone who was smart would say. And certainly, I'm doing that right now.
I do that professionally.
So I'm not flaming him for it, but everyone was like, no, dude, I mean, he could just work for NASA if he didn't want to play in the NBA. I'm like, sure, man. I don't know. It seems...
Could be a director of interior if he wanted to, but, you know, he's 7'6", so he's here.
It's a weird move, too, I think, whenever somebody is that age. I guess you have to teach him, but I would think they would, like, bench you for the first half.
Yeah, like a college first quarter benching against the Citadel for Alabama.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it was just, I didn't know the whole story because, I don't know, it's been a crazy, whenever you have a game Sunday and then another game Saturday.
There was no story beforehand. No one knew. It wasn't on the injury report. No one knew until the postgame.
I was behind.
He was in his warmups.
Yeah, I was behind the times on my Orlando Magic research leading into the game. So I just assumed there was something that had happened that I was just not privy to.
Dude, he played on Friday night. And he played on Friday night and he played the game. So I guess what I'm trying to say is they were not on a back-to-back. Mm-hmm. They weren't. They had 2.5 days off.
Yeah.
And
which Atlanta has a long break, too, for before
they
Wednesday.
Also have not played since Friday,
yeah.
I believe. Yeah, so he is playing like 20 minutes a night,
mm-hmm.
18, 20 minutes a night. He's been decent. He hit all three of his threes in a game just a couple nights ago.
Oh, man.
To get to like 30%.
That's just catnip for the Texas fan.
There's no doubt.
For the T-shirt fan that has adopted Sheck West as their ringtone.
I got to tell you, I cannot believe that team was 500 a week ago.
Oh, that's the worst shooting team I've seen this year.
And I know they were without Fournier, who's a pretty nice player.
He's okay.
But that is absolute doo-doo.
I mean, when Kim Birch is your solution, they're like, we're getting blown out.
You didn't get my kombucha joke.
Kim, I don't know what it is.
Kombucha's that drink.
I know what the drink is.
But like every single time our PA guy would say, he would say, kombucha.
Oh, okay.
Like it sounded like he was saying kombucha instead of birch. It's just kombucha.
Just a phonetic joke. Okay, I thought there was something else.
Kim Birch. Kim
I thought
Birch?
I was like Googling kombucha NBA, like trying to figure out this.
Those are my favorite tweets, the ones that leave you a little confused.
Yeah, it was like I was Nick Cage and National Treasure, like reversing the Declaration of Independence, trying to figure out what you're talking about.
Well, that guy got heavy run.
Oh yeah, Kim. I thought
Kim Birch.
Charks looks at me and goes, "Oh, that's Kim Birch," and I go, "Kemp Birch." His dad named him after Sean Kemp.
He's not young.
I was like, "That's rad." I was like a big fan, and then I realized his name is Cam.
Kim.
Kim Birch, like the tree, and I was like, "Oh, I'm out." Instantly, yeah. I thought he was named after Sean Kemp.
I would have really liked to see Bamba play, though.
Yeah.
Just like it would be a real bummer if, for whatever reason, Trae Young doesn't play Wednesday or Bagley Sunday. I want to see these guys play, and I want to see him play with Luka.
Yeah, of course. I wanted to see Sala versus Bamba in the fourth quarter and just see what kind of hell got raised.
Oh, my God.
Because that game was over. I looked at Bobby maybe 5 minutes left in the first quarter, and I go, these sons of bitches aren't scoring 80.
No.
That team, without Fournier moving the rock and rolling out DJ Augustine at Dollar Store JJ Barea is what I called him, out there for heavy minutes, I was like, this team is
terrible. And they were 12-12
yeah.
a mere week ago.
Yes, they were the surprise team of the East.
It kind of feels now, and by the way, I've bought their BS before.
Oh, the Magic?
It's
never
been
have.
A while, but it was probably 4 years ago.
I never dipped
maybe
into that
we were
fun
doing
dip.
Locked on, maybe, but.
Probably.
I mean, you look at it on paper, and over the years, it seems like they have had a lot of really good picks.
Yeah.
It almost seems like they did okay in the Dwight trade, given what they got back for.
Well, they never hit bottom hard enough.
No, they
didn't. They always had like a 5-7 pick, right?
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much.
And they bailed on Depot really early. And what are they? They got Sabonis back, I guess? No, I don't even remember. They had Sabonis and Depot, didn't they?
Yeah.
And they flipped that for Serge. Oh, God. If they just sat still, if they replaced whatever two GMs ago that was with a Fern, they could have Sabonis and Depot.
Yeah, and it's kind of hard to keep track of, too, because they've been involved in so many trades.
Yeah,
because like
they'll move guys.
Oladipo was second overall. Aaron Gordon was fourth overall. Hazonia was a miss.
Yeah, the church.
Isaac.
Dude, it was.
I still think is going to be fine.
Dude, I think that's a lesson we could probably stuff into our back pocket of they did nothing like that wrong besides Max Biombo and trade for Ibaka.
Yeah.
Like those are their two like Achilles cutting moves that just short circuited their rebuild. And just paying a big like that that's limited minutes wise, number one, and then with Biombo and then Ibaka, you know, I don't know. He
and
fits
then
well in Toronto, but
they also won't. It's a weird deal to give an Aaron Gordon-like contract when you're going to be as bad as they are.
That was confusing.
Because I like him. I don't know what he is. I know we had talked about it, the possibility that he could end up here.
Mm-hmm.
You really can't play him even as a small ball five, but
yeah,
they try some.
They feel like us coming out of 2016.
Yeah.
Where, I mean, Gordon isn't new to their team. Barnes was new to our team. But we were like, we need this guy. We need somebody,
roughly.
Yeah. We need somebody to get buckets.
At the time.
We need somebody that we think is a good player with upside. And, you know, we don't want to be a bottom five team in the NBA.
Yeah.
So here we go.
And maybe it'll work out, and maybe they just had a terrible night. But they're the worst. I think they're both the worst free throw shooting team in the league, and they get the fewest.
Wow.
Last night was one away from a Mavericks opposition record. They went 4 of 5. On the night.
That should be a quarter.
Yeah. Well, it was for Dallas.
Yeah.
They went 4 of 5 in the first quarter and I think they only had 3 heading into the fourth. So they were right there on the edge.
Wow.
But
what an incredible game.
You don't shoot threes. You turn the ball over a lot and you get to the line 5 times in 48 minutes. It's going to be.
Yeah.
The game was 1 hour and 56 minutes long.
Yeah.
That was incredible. I just looked up and was like, what's happening? I totally didn't realize that we were.
How do I do a post game show on this? Yeah.
It was wild. We spent about 5 minutes on the game and then started talking about other stuff.
One of our stepsons, Jonathan Isaac, I don't know if that guy's stagnated. I don't know what his deal is. I want him to be really, really good.
I could see a situation where he ends up as a 4 next to Bamba. Now, what does that mean Aaron Gordon is?
Right.
Probably not there.
Where's Gordon and where's Vooch?
Vooch is gone.
Yeah, Vooch is a free.
I believe it, yeah. And you know what? He's younger, I think, than people think he is.
He's 28.
Yeah. It feels like he's been doing this for a long time, though. And
did he play professional before USC?
He
is that right?
No, he's been with the Magic a long time.
Okay. He might have just had some quiet first 2 seasons or something.
Well, I mean, he was. Did he have any overlap with Dwight? He had to have had a little bit, right?
Maybe a season. Maybe one.
I've always liked
that guy's
him,
been playing
I
great.
Don't.
I wanted to see him play well last night.
Yeah.
Like, I wanted to get an up-close look at Vooch and just to get a little scouting report, you know, put that in the notebook and so I have proper feelings about him. And then he just, I don't know what that team was doing last night. I have no explanation for.
It's really bad.
Like, Jonathan Simmons doing weird stuff and Isaac's launching threes. And I'm not even looking at the ball. I just watch the guy that's shooting and I'm like, nope, that ain't happening. Yeah. Looks like he has like a hitch somehow in his lower body and he's just like flinging the ball and it's the loudest miss you've ever heard. And then Vooch is like, I don't know.
He was actually traded this is where it gets really confusing.
Oh no. The trade, the rights to his pick?
Well, the trade between the Sixers and the Magic.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That involved picks that were like Nerlens and Dwight Howard ended up going to
Lakers.
Yeah, initially he was traded to Philadelphia. I think it was Philadelphia was involved. Bynum was involved.
Oh God, I was about to ask.
Was
Bynum
involved? Yeah, so they had no Bynum overlap. But anyways,
Anyway, let's tease the show. I guess I'm Mike. He's Jake. This is the 4-pointer, episode 13 for the season. This week we're going to talk about just how good Luka is. Can the Mavs get to 17-11 here pretty quick? And I already did my Mo Bamba joke, so let's go ahead and delete that. Vitals right now. We did bring a lot this week. I had some time to prepare. Some weeks we just come in here and go stream of consciousness. If you can't tell, if you don't keep score at home and make your own little rundown, your own little run sheet, so you can criticize us. And you might say, hey, you don't bring anything every week, and I'd say, hey, meet me outside.
Ooh.
But this week we brought some stuff. We brought some stats because things are good. 14-11, 7-3 in their last 10. 10 straight home wins. Top 13 in the SI power ranking. And the, what's the other one? I don't know. ESPN, they're 10th actually, which was very surprising. Wins against Oklahoma City, Utah, Golden State, Boston, Houston 2 times. Clippers and Portland in the last month. 12-4 since the game that we will never speak of again. The
Got to have one every year.
Yep. 12th in offensive rating since that time. 3rd in defensive rating. 5th in net rating. 7th in defensive rebound percentage. 7th in true shooting percentage. 3rd in opponent field goal percentage. And 3rd in opponent three-point percentage. That's just a good defensive team. I don't know another way to cut it. I mean, it's been that was the second, so it's been like 38, 39 days of them playing really good basketball. And since the last time we talked, let me plug one thing real quick. The 20th of this month, so 9 days from now, so a week from Thursday, we're going to do a live four-pointer slash numbers on the board mashup podcast. I haven't found a great title for it yet, but we'll slap something on there. It'll be Jake Kemp, Jeff Skinwade, Bobby Corella, and me, Mike Marshall, at a watch party over off of McKinney in Dallas. McKinney's the street, not the town. Christie's is the establishment. Gonna be there about 8 to 9. Do a little live podcast for you, entertain the folk before we take on the Los Angeles Clippers. That's a late game, a 9:30 tip. So this will be your pregame. It's a TNT game, too, so there's no other pregame going on. No other Fox duties are happening. We were going to get Follow, but he's doing, like, Texas State High School football games that day. Yeah, Jeff Skinwade, Jake, Bobby, and me will be there to entertain you for about an hour, hour 15, before the Clippers game at Christie's off McKinney on the 20th. Please be there and hang out and watch the game with us. All right, that's out of the way. Since the last time we talked, we beat Portland, we lost in New Orleans, we beat Houston, and we beat Orlando last night. Let's kind of take away a few notes from each one of these games and how we feel about it and what we learned. And overall, whenever we're done with this little rundown, I think we can see how we feel about everything 25 games in, see how it's coming together, see what exactly we're messing with here. But the Portland win, that was one of those, okay, if you beat this team, they were in a mess of a way, reading Damian Lillard's post-game comments, where he just sounded like he was just in full despair. He's like, man, we try, and we have good minutes here and there, but we never put it together, and it's just, it sounded like a lost man in his post-game. And maybe that's the excuse for them not playing very well, but that was the game after, that was the day of the Dennis Root Canal game. That was the last time he's played, actually. And furthermore on that, I don't know what exactly his wrist issue is, man. To miss a game, come back, play your ass off for a game, and then miss two more games, I'm not sure what's going on with that. I have no explanation for what's going on with his wrist. I don't know if it was a tough guy thing wanting to play after his tooth got knocked out. But obviously his shooting's not been as good since he hurt his wrist and the limited shots that he's taken. And someone wanted to point that out on Twitter. And I was like, I think the point was, why is anybody talking about this? And the conversation goes like this. Begin scene. Dennis isn't shooting very well since he hurt his wrist. Well, yeah, he hurt his wrist. End scene.
Yeah. And really it's just from three.
Yeah.
I mean, his numbers overall are not really any different. You're talking about since he came back after Boston.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it's got to be the Boston.
And then got beat up against Houston.
Mm-hmm.
But, man, I'm not worried about him.
No, I'm not worried about him at all. And I think one of the things, I was driving over here, I was thinking, like, okay, who has had to sacrifice stuff? Who has had to, like, remold their identity since Luka's been here? And it's almost 100% been Dennis. Like, he's taking the brunt of it, right? And it's not, you know, it doesn't have to be a negative thing. Everyone assumes, like, you know, reshaping your game and finding something other than scoring, which is really fun, finding different ways to contribute is a negative thing. But I think for Dennis turning into, you know, a plus defensively, a guy that does the simple things and pushing the pace and driving at the basket and trying to get foul calls and, you know, just making the simple play like we saw Jalen Brunson do last night, for a lot of his minutes, he's had the most to sacrifice thus far.
It was always going to be that way.
Yeah, and I think we were kind of dumb for not pointing it out, to thinking that everything's going to, you know, it's going to lift, the tide is going to lift all the boats. And it's kind of a very mature thing for him, I feel, because there's no way around the fact that Luka being here and him changing to this role to help the team win is going to cost his long-term value. Like if he's an 18 to 20 point a game guy with five assists and, you know, is just empty numbers here and there, someone, maybe it's the Mavs, maybe it's whoever, at the end of his rookie contract is going to look at that and go, hey, that guy, I can at least sell that guy. You know, that's a big contract guy. And if he's this kind of role player now, who's just 15 points a game, five assists, a couple boards, and, you know, doesn't play on the ball that much, that's just a less valuable in terms of a contract player. But it helps the team win more.
Yeah, I think that to go to the same point of his value being the highest to Dallas, it working out here,
mm-hmm.
I could see them paying him more than someone else would in a lesser role just because they'll know that he's still helping them win.
Yeah.
If he's willing to sacrifice, which is, it's not a matter of whether or not he's going to have to. It's a matter of whether or not he's willing to.
Yeah, whether he accepts it.
That's pretty much already happening.
Yeah. I mean, that happens when like a top 25 player gets added to your team. Yeah. The fact that we weren't convinced that Luka was from day one, or some people weren't, that doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
Now the reality of it is you've got a guy that the team is going to be built around for hopefully the next 15 years.
But another huge game from the bench in Portland.
Yeah.
That's
where they got short-circuited. Like, they threw Evan Turner out there for like 25 minutes. He was their bench. And they were like begging Zach Collins, Myers Leonard, etc. to score 10 points, and they just couldn't do it. And then we go to New Orleans. And that was one of the biggest buzzkills of the season.
You could have seen that coming a mile away.
Yeah, I did. But still, that's one of those, there's something to gain and lose from this game. You know what I mean? Like, some nights you go up against the second night of a back-to-back. I mean, I guess this is the example, but I don't know. I felt like if you win that, you're changing my perception of, okay, this might be an eighth seed, like mess around, final week of the season, challenge for playoffs type stuff. And I still, you know, think pretty highly of them on the whole, but I don't know why we haven't found an answer for Julius Randle in the 4 or 5 years he's been in the league. And I don't know if it's just extra juice from him when he sees Dallas, hometown thing, but we do not match up well with the Pelicans.
Well, I mean, I think that's what happens when you end up playing. Most nights you can play threes at four,
mm-hmm.
and it's not that big of a deal, but they have legit two guys who are both 5'4"s.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't care what you want to call which one of them. We only have one guy on the floor. You almost would have a better chance starting Maxi.
Yeah.
Over, and I don't want to take Barnes off the floor. So at that point, basically now I'm sliding all over the place. But if you're going to play the three-wing game, Julius Randle is going to F you up.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, you can try to throw different junk defenses at them, but you're not going to stop both those guys. Your hope is that you can stop one of them.
With Dennis out, I feel like that kind of changed almost everything because Drew can slide over to Luka.
Yeah.
And then they were just kind of daring HB and Maxi to shoot wide open threes.
Which sometimes –
going to live with it.
Sometimes teams have to pay for it. I would say last night.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, at home, I feel like those shots go in for whatever reason. I don't know why. Going down to New Orleans on the second night of a back-to-back without Dennis. Was someone else out that game?
Maxi did play.
Maxi played. It might have just been Dennis, but it just felt like they were shorthanded from the jump.
Well, they didn't play their starters at all. Like in the, I mean, it was over in the third quarter.
Yeah, which I guess is
skews the numbers a little.
Yeah. And that one kind of, I don't know why, it just kind of shook my confidence to see them get kicked around so hard. And the thing that whenever they do go on the road and they do look like a garbage team is whenever they don't play transition defense. I mean, the Lakers did it to them. And I don't think they were quite ready for the Pelicans are going to get the ball up with 2 seconds. And Moore or Solomon Hill or Drew or somebody is shooting a three immediately. If they get the ball up quick. And I don't think they were ready for that kind of velocity. I don't know if it was Luka. I don't know what the defensive disconnect was, but it was bad and it was painful.
Also, they're going to be a bad team on the second night of back-to-backs this year. They just are.
Yeah.
There's just no way around it. I mean, I'll tell you, as excited as we are all about Luka, if you want to go to Houston,
mm-hmm.
If you take out those four shots that he hit at the end of the Houston game, he's been bad.
Yeah.
And I'm not like off the, you know, he's obviously their best player. He's going to be their best player for a long time. it's really, really tight that he can still help you out whenever he's going to go 2 of 11 like he did last night and have generally nothing from three. But if you take out those four shots at the end of the Houston game, since the Laker game a couple Fridays ago, he's shooting 30%.
Yeah.
And he's shooting like 25% from three. And some of that is probably his hip.
Mm-hmm.
Some of it is probably that, I mean, dude, this is going to be a grind for him. You know, he didn't have a real offseason. I heard Zach Lowe say this to Tim McMahon the other day, and I 100% agree and wish I would have said it first. He's definitely lost weight in the last 2 months because he is running. You can tell his body is just not used to this.
Yeah.
And that's not to say, like, whenever people talk about, well, and I think we're going to talk about it today on the Hardline, like, whoa, why didn't people see this coming? I keep saying the part that, because it's not all one thing. There are different things that you can see coming or not. The one thing you should have seen coming is that he's definitely not afraid of the big moment because he's been in tons of them.
Mm-hmm.
You should have seen coming that he is his vision and that he's going to be able to read the floor and make passes that you don't usually see rookies make. You also absolutely should see coming that in the middle of the season, he is going to be like, man, this is pretty tough.
Yeah.
This is tough. And I know they play a lot of games and in a lot of tournaments and they play
national
teams.
They're shorter games though, man.
They're shorter games and they
don't run the ball like we do. Sorry.
I don't think they're running back-to-backs either. They may, but that's a pretty serious turnaround.
I think they go like soccer schedule, like Tuesday, Saturday type stuff.
That's what it always seemed like to me. And maybe some of the tournaments are different, but
yeah.
I'm sure he'll be fine, but I wouldn't even be mad if they set him down for a couple games.
Got him a little rest.
In the next couple weeks.
Yeah.
Which nobody's going to be cool with, especially if Dennis is still out, and especially if Dirk is still out. But
I feel like that's what they did in the Clippers game.
Yeah.
And, you know, it worked out fine. I would pick my spots with him to be like, okay, this is a self-care day, buddy.
Yeah.
Like, spa day for you. Let's, why don't you just
charcoal mask.
Yeah. Just go disappear for a little while and come back. I'll see you Tuesday. But they do. I think at home, I was really surprised they set him at the Clipper game, by the way, because that's a home game. That's a premium matchup type game. But for him, everything you said is correct. He's lost weight. His upper body just looks a little different as of right now. His arms look different. He's gotten more confidence where he's not wearing the undershirt. Which is, you know, just body confidence.
Did he not have one on last night?
He did not wear one last night.
I didn't notice that.
Yeah, he wore one.
I don't mind it.
For about a month. No, I don't mind the undershirt. I wish he'd wear just a black one, though.
Yeah.
I don't know why I hate the white undershirt. I just assume it's going to turn into sweat-colored.
Well, you can't wear a black undershirt.
With a white jersey?
You have to wear black tights then.
Oh, okay.
You can wear blue bottoms with a white top. You're only going to get this
so
here.
So dumb. Yeah, exactly.
But you can't wear a black undershirt up top and have blue bottoms.
That's so dumb.
I swear that makes sense to me, though.
It doesn't make sense
and
to me
And I won't
at all.
Wear white bottoms at all.
I only wear white bottoms.
Tights. I can't wear white tights because I feel like you have to be kind of fast.
It's like if you have the wristband, you got to be kind of fast.
The black
like,
and the gray ones,
because
I've converted to tights under my shorts now in the gym.
Oh, yeah, I've worn them for a long time.
But I can't wear white. It just seems like it's putting an expectation on me that's
I don't want to let anybody down. I don't know why. I think
you're smooth though. You're not fast, but you are smooth.
I think the first person I saw white dude that I saw do it like all the time was Parsons. And
yeah.
He always wore white on white on white on white. Like he was just whited out.
It's badass.
At home and it looks cool.
Yeah, no, it looks really cool.
It looks crispy. Like whenever Luka is wearing the whites, I'm like, okay, the white undershirt works. But if it's the blue for some reason, we wore blue at home the other day.
Yeah.
And then the city edition.
Yeah.
Wear the black. Roll the black out there. Get some black tights. Let's go. I know
black tights are perfect with the city edition.
Yeah. I mean, you might look like a Navy SEAL rolling up on the beach at 4:30 a.m., but it's fine. It's cool. You look neat.
But the two things we got in the Clipper game and last night were like really weird celebrations.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I just want to say that since I haven't really heard Mo Bamba in the wild, and I don't really, I'm pretty out of it these days, and that's pre-debut, so I'm sure this is only going to get worse. I just assume that anything that I don't understand that I see a younger person doing, I'm just like, classic Fortnite. I don't know what he was doing last night, but I assume it has something to do with gaming.
No, I don't think
his
it does.
Bunny hops.
I don't think it does.
You can't
I'm
convince
not,
me of that.
I'm not entirely certain. I feel like we're the two old guys in Sesame Street that are up in the balcony that are yelling at kids or something. Like someone just brought in a Nintendo DS and we're like, ah, what is that? What kind of magic tool is this? But I think that was
Stadler
just,
and Waldorf.
There you go.
My brother used to do that routine.
I think
our hearts are painted black.
I think that's a him and DeAndre thing.
Yeah, it looked like it, but
I think that's an inside joke between them because DeAndre started doing it back.
Yeah.
And they did it again later, and I was like, what is happening?
But like he still had 11 boards and 9 assists in a game where he sucked
yes.
and didn't play really in the fourth quarter at all.
Yes. So, and in a game, okay, they get their asses kicked in that Houston game. Like, they were down 8, right? Going into the final 2.5 minutes.
Yeah.
And he hits the corner 3. He scores 11 in a row. He just goes blue steel on him. That's a Zoolander reference, Jake. I know you don't like movies, but
I do like that one.
Oh, okay. He goes blue steel, and it's cool to know that he can be quiet and have like a borderline really bad game, 10 points through whatever, 45 minutes, and then 3 minutes left in the game, he's like, you know what? I'm going straight at Clint Capella, James Harden, PJ Tucker. Bring them all. Whatever you want. He's just like swinging on everybody.
Yeah.
And that's really, really stinking cool. And that's not something a 19-year-old not named LeBron James does.
Yeah, it's also really cool because teams want to switch, but he can beat you so badly in the post that mm-hmm. if he ends up drawing a guy who's not that good, like if you leave a guard on him, he will take you to the block.
Yeah.
And he can find shooters out of the block. He can just, he'll wait forever on up and unders. Who did he do it to last night? I think he did it to Isaac last night, which is weird
yeah.
because I think it was a fast break. Somebody baseball passed it down the floor to him, or football pass. I guess you don't pass in baseball. Baseball throw.
Relay.
And he just waited on the defender and just up and under,
yeah.
and got to the line. So on one hand, you're like, okay, I'm going to switch, and now he ends up with PJ Tucker or Clint Capella on him, and Clint Capella is just like, what are you, why are you making me do this?
What's wrong with that dude, by the way?
I don't know. I mean, I think that they're asking too much of him.
Well, I think he had a little too much fun after that contract.
Maybe, but I think that what the Rockets ask their big to do is...
Yeah, it's impossible.
So then the other option is you just leave Harden on him.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, dude, I will yeah. absolutely take you down. Or even if it's not Harden, just a guard. So yeah. he's a cheat code for sure. But,
yeah.
His shot is going to come and go as he works through the rigors of an NBA season. And right now it is in decidedly the going.
Mm-hmm. What I think about on most games whenever I watch him, I see him make some spectacular passes and find people that just things that I don't even see sitting, 500 feet up, looking basically straight down the court. I don't even see this guy open yet. And he makes this pass. Maybe once a game he does it. And then on, in the Boston game, I think it was more in your face. It was more, right in front of your grill. He did it like the first 5 possessions where he's like, you know what? I'm going to show off my passing. The only thing I can think is they're asking him to be more of an ISO player than a distributor, even if Dennis is out. And I don't know if I think that helps them win more right now because that offense can get so clunky at times with ISO Barnes, with DeAndre, who if he's not dunking the basketball or spinning to dunk the basketball, it might be a turnover. And you don't want Wes, mixing it up, heating the ball up. I think that might be, it feels like it's almost to the detriment of his overall progress to not have him distribute the basketball as much as humanly possible. But they also need somebody that can get buckets and win right now because we're apparently a pretty stinking good team.
Yeah.
That's
what a lot of this comes down to is
what wins now versus what's the long-term development and is the distributing the basketball, the point guard instincts in this league, something you can work on in the offseason or in practice rather than actual in-game. And I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. That's probably something Rick's thought about not even had a conversation about, just something that he's worked through his mind. Like, do I want this guy to, you know, how do I want to utilize him?
And it can be, it can be possession by possession.
Oh, for sure. It can be quarter by quarter. It can be like, we're going to run these plays, run these three set plays in a sequence type thing.
Because I feel like last night, he was able to get Barnes involved quite a bit.
Yeah. He moved the ball really well last
night.
Barnes
had a really nice night shooting last night.
Mm-hmm. He knocked down his open threes, got to the bucket and forced free throws and layups. Like, that's all you need from Barnes right now.
Yeah.
Like, I even start, you know, turning my eye towards, okay, buddy, you're not assisting at all.
He definitely is not even looking to.
Like, what's your overall effect? But then you get into a game and you're watching possession by possession and you're like, you just need somebody to pace this team for this next 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And Barnes does that as well as almost anybody.
He's pretty good at giving what the game calls for.
Yes. Yeah, last night he had a weird handle. I don't know what the whole court looked like. It was like had Nickelodeon ooze on it. I don't know what was going on last night. Everyone was falling. The ball was getting loose. But yeah, Luka
took a three.
Luka should have been allowed to try and chase a triple double, but got pulled pretty early.
See, I
played in the fourth.
I don't really care that much about triple doubles, so I would.
The concept of triple doubles, or just
nah, it's really cool to have a guy that can line it up, can light it up and fill it up in three or four different categories. But I can't, at one hand, say I don't want to overexpose this kid.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, say, would you please go try to give Kombucha another couple layups? But as we jump around here, you mentioned DeAndre and the turnovers. I know that's one thing you had written down.
Yeah.
To a certain extent, the way that they score or that they chart these things, I think, is unfair, because I think a lot of his turnovers, and he's been, I just pulled it up. If you look at the top 44 role men, he's 34th in turnover percentage. Like, that's, I mean, it's bad. But sometimes I think that he gets charted with turnovers that are Luka's fault.
Sure.
And last night, Luka ended up with two. And I looked at the stat sheet after the game, and I'm like, man, I feel like he fumbled the ball away like at least two or three other times, because he'll give DeAndre a pass that ends up not being charted as a pass attempt or as a shot attempt for DeAndre, but he touches it.
Yeah.
And so I don't know. I'd love to see the subjectiveness of
what does a bad oop count as?
Like, yeah, because they've got to be pretty high on the list of failed oop per percent. But you know, I was gonna say, per percentage, if you waited and added in the bench, that would probably bring it back up, because they almost never screw that up.
Yeah.
Because if Dwight Powell doesn't finish, he'll catch and recalibrate.
He still gets the ball off. It's so weird.
Exactly.
He finishes it a lot of times.
Yeah.
Just off weird falling down stuff.
Yeah.
And I was really worried last night that he separated his shoulder whenever he went diving into the baseline. I was like, dude, we're up 24 right now. Stop it.
He doesn't know.
And he goes one speed on that automobile. But yeah, the DeAndre stuff, the overall turnover stuff, I feel like a lot of them are throwing the ball at DeAndre's feet because you didn't create a good enough passing lane. You know what I mean? And then DeAndre gets charted with a turnover because a ball hit him in the shin and he barely got his hand on. And then he's stumbling as on the other, that baseline down there. And then the ball's coming the other way. And there's not a ton of live ball backcourt turnovers, but there's a lot of you won the play and you didn't execute step 5 of 5.
Yeah.
And that kind of, those drive me insane, because the two lobs that he missed in the first quarter, I feel like those were 70-30 his fault. Or I don't know. And though that's a really stinking difficult play. You can watch somebody as talented as DeAndre miss that, and you finally get appreciation for what Capella does and what Gobert does every single play and how often they actually finish that roll in that oop. But that's why the turnover numbers are as bad as they are, because most people don't have a center that turns the ball over 3 times a game.
Yeah.
Or gets charted for turnovers 3 times a game.
I'm going to see if I can pull this up here, but I also would bet that despite the amount that they give up, let's see here. Yeah, so they turn the ball over a lot, but they're still middle of the pack in the points that opponents get off of turnovers.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's, like you said, it's not as much as they're just getting ripped on the perimeter and giving up a fast break. it's just a failed lob attempt that turns into a basically another half-court possession for the opponent. It doesn't end up providing as many easy looks. So that's one, I guess, saving grace, is that a lot of their turnovers come from
that. Well, it's obviously not killing them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, they're third or something in turnover percentage overall or turnovers per game, and they're, you know, whatever the hell I quoted earlier, 12-4 team.
Yeah.
The last month.
And they're 17th in as far as points allowed off of turnovers.
So they've circumvented this
pretty much average.
This old adage of turn the ball over, you suck type stuff. But and it's not even like the pace. Like they're running at like a 15th in the league pace now. They're very average now. After the first 2 weeks, it's really normalized. Okay, so a couple things I was thinking of that I wanted to throw at you. Me and Bobby sit around and do this all the time, which is kind of just weigh the value of Luka, and we do it almost on a daily basis. When you take into account the age, 19, he's a 90th percentile player right now, which is when people ask me, what is he? Like, what am I looking at here? Okay, he's a 90th percentile player in the league at age 19. The contract, which is a rookie contract, at least for 5 years, so four after this one, who has greater value right now in the league? And you start going down the top of the top and just see how far you get. So Anthony Davis. I think Anthony Davis has more value right now.
Sure.
Joel Embiid. Yeah. I'm saying yeah. Even with a max, whatever max Embiid has. Curry, probably yeah. LeBron, well, of course. Durant, yeah.
I'm actually going to tell you that right now I would not trade Luka for LeBron.
Really?
Yeah, because, I mean, LeBron has still got a few years left, but I'm talking, you really have to be thinking about having 9 years of this player.
Yeah.
Even if only four of them are cost-controlled.
Mm-hmm.
I'm getting 19 through 28. Almost guaranteed he's on my roster. And at that point, he'll still only be on his second contract. LeBron is making the max for a player who's been in the league for, you know, 9+ years or whatever it is. And even if he's doing shorter deals and isn't able to get the percentage raise increases that if you take a 5-year deal, LeBron will be out of the league in 4 years.
Yeah.
He'll be 37 or 38.
I know, but adding the best player in the league for the next, I think he's still got 2 years after this one and probably at least. That's hard to, I don't know. I see your point.
I mean,
assuming a rookie guy doesn't just take the qualifying for the
fifth year. Usually you lock that person off after their fourth year.
You can keep them 10 years basically, right? Or is it 9?
Well, usually I think what happens is that the second deal kind of
starts on the fifth year. Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, but that's not even true, I don't think.
I don't think so.
But either. I think it is 9. I think it ends up being 9 years, but maybe it. And they don't have to sign it. You know, yeah. He could easily say, I don't want to take the full max deal. And I guess it would be interesting to see if players who are earlier in their careers start doing 2-1s, but they're leaving money, a lot of money on the table by doing that.
Right. Okay, so Harden.
I would take Luka.
Kawhi.
Oh, Kawhi is out of his freaking mind right now. That's an easy one.
Lillard. I think that's easy for Luka.
Yeah, I think I would take Doncic.
Jokic.
I would take Jokic.
Kyrie.
I would take Kyrie.
Towns.
I would take Luka.
Paul George.
How old is Paul George? 27?
Yeah, somewhere around there.
And the only reason that one's a little bit weird is that he's free. Or no.
No, he's like, he'll
locked
up
with them at his Nas concert.
Yeah.
Man, I think I'm still probably taking Paul George because Paul George is 5 years younger than LeBron. So I still get maybe a larger chunk there.
Big James Butler. I think I'm taking Luka.
Yeah.
And then Westbrook. I think I'm taking Luka.
Yeah, I mean, there might be other guys. I mean, I would take Durant.
Yeah.
I would take... that's probably it, actually.
Yeah, I mean, for my fandom, I don't know if I'd take I mean, we forgot to mention Giannis, but
yeah, Giannis, that's a definite.
So there's like eight players in the league that I believe have more value than Luka Doncic right now. That's what it comes down to. Like actual on paper, 19 years old, rookie contract at plus skill level. So cost, age, skill level.
Yeah.
All added into the same formula. I just wanted everybody to get their minds around that. Because we do this almost every day. Me and Bobby just yell at each other. Like yell this name. Nope. All right, so we do have a real chance of going, getting to 17 and 11 here because next two opponents are Atlanta and then who the hell we play next? I'm sorry.
Sacramento, I think.
Sacramento. And let me pull up the schedule. I don't know why I'm blanking on this. Schedule Phoenix. Phoenix is the back-to-back, right?
Oh, okay, that's right. And then back here, so you got to go to Phoenix and then back here.
So Atlanta Sunday. Wednesday, Thursday Phoenix, and then Sunday Kings. So you're going to be favored in the next two, probably the next three, because you're playing Sacramento at home. Just think about when this team was 2-7, if I told you, hey, man, a month from now, we're going to be 17-11. When you get that many games over 500, like, it's hard to fall, like, sharply enough to get too far below 500.
It is, but you have to keep it. And I know that the schedule, saying strength of schedule this year and this early is not near as much as it was in years past.
Mm-hmm.
Because everything's a lot less defined. And I don't, honestly, I expect them to lose one of these games. And it really is a weird deal because Phoenix is the back-to-back. I don't believe they've won a back-to-back this year.
Mavs have not.
And yeah, so Phoenix is not good, but
You owe both of them. Like
you do.
Sacramento is one that scares me.
And Phoenix hasn't won in forever.
Yeah. Atlanta, they're pissed at them, obviously. But these are the two teams they played in their home openers and lost to.
Yeah.
Like, if you're going to kick the S out of some teams, it's these two. And then Sacramento might, I don't know. We haven't seen Sacramento in a while. They might be a weird matchup for us. You know, someone might miss that game and then it turns into, but that's at home.
But you could mess around and lose the next four, no problem.
It gets difficult after that.
So I just want to keep in the, I'm totally okay with everything that happens, even if they do lose four in a row in a week like that.
Yeah. Well, that's my overall point that I think I've come to, with all this basketball data that I keep forcing into my brain on a nightly basis is,
I've seen enough.
I've seen what I needed to see.
Right.
They've played extremely good basketball for 5 weeks straight. They have somewhat of an identity at home and being an awesome home team. Luka is good enough to build around, and everyone else has accepted their role of like fitting in to what they've been assigned to do. So no matter what happens the rest of this season, I know they can be a really good team.
Yeah, and I kind of got a boogie.
Yeah,
but maybe we'll wait another week and see what the Brunson conversation is like then.
Yeah.
Because this keeps happening where
he's been really good.
He's been really good and his 3-point numbers are pretty bad.
Right.
But if you look at his college numbers, it wasn't like with Justin Anderson where he went from 26% to 43% in 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
He had a stair step from like 33 to 37 to 40.
Yeah.
And I don't think I realized that. So his shot looked really, really bad at times in summer league. He was getting good shots.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I still tend to think that he's going to be a decent NBA 3-point shooter. And he's not small.
No.
He's not big, but he's kind of
thick. He's kind of like extra large Barea.
Yeah. He's like 6'2", 6'3", isn't he?
Yeah. He's probably 6'2".
So, who knows? You can already see it brewing of, well, then I guess he should be the starter. And Rick didn't exactly say last night. Rick just said, hey, we'll just have to see how it all plays out. But
when he did say another Donnie Nelson home run or something like that, I was like, bro, we're 25 games in. You sat him the other night. Like,
yeah, but it is still a second-round pick.
Yeah.
And if a second-round pick can come in and start and you don't just totally notice them being the worst player on the floor.
Yeah, that's
now,
something.
It's also DeMarcus Lawrence in that everybody says second-round pick, but if you're 33rd, there are enough people that thought that you were first.
Right.
So,
yeah.
It doesn't really matter what he is. What matters is that he's good.
Yeah.
Or he's not bad. How about that?
For point of reference, he's played 63 minutes with the starters, basically in Dennis's spot, and they're plus 9.9 overall in net rating. 80% defensive rebound percentage and the best passing numbers other than a lineup with Berea in it, basically. So they move the ball really well. They do run